So let's talk a little bit about how Mendelian randomization works. Basically, we can use Mendelian randomization to do two things. The first is that we can use it to assess whether there's a causal relationship between two variables. Second, if there is a causal relationship between those two variables, then we can get it to estimate the magnitude of that causal effect. And Mendelian randomization does this by harnessing Mendel's laws of inheritance. Specifically, Mendelian randomization uses Mendel's law of segregation. So that's basically the idea that which alleles you receive from your parents are random. And most importantly, they're random with respect to environmental confounders. So in other words, which allele at a locus is transmitted from your father or your mother, that's a random process with respect to environmental confounders. The second of Mendel's laws of inheritance is the law of independent assortment. And this says that a locus segregates independent of the rest of the genome. So what that means is that alleles at a particular locus are segregating independently with respect to other genetically influenced traits. I often think that it's useful to conceptualize Mendelian randomization similar to a randomized control trial. So in an RCT, we physically randomize individuals into a treatment group and into a placebo group. This randomization process ensures that on average, those two groups are equal with respect to both known and unknown confounders. So that means that when we follow up the two groups at a later date, if there's any difference between them, then it has to be because of our treatment. And so we can say that the treatment causes the outcome. One of the ways to think about Mendelian randomization is like nature's randomized control trials. So basically, Mendelian randomization uses Mendel's laws of segregation and independent assortment to randomly assign individuals to an exposed group and a control group. So in the exposed group, they'll have some functional alleles, and in the control group, they'll have some null alleles. And this random segregation and independent assortment again ensures that on average, those two groups are equal with respect to both their known and unknown confounders. So what that means is that if we compare those two groups in terms of an outcome that we're interested in, if there is a difference between the two groups in terms of their outcome, then that's evidence that the exposure causes the outcome. To make this a little bit more concrete, let's think of a fictitious example. Let's say we're interested in whether smoking causes lung cancer. So one way we could do this in theory is we could conduct a randomized control trial. So we would take a group of individuals and we would randomly assign them to a treatment group. So let's say we get individuals and we lock them in a room for 30 years and we get them to smoke a pack of cigarettes a day. And the other half of the individuals are randomly assigned to a control group where they're locked in a room for 30 years and they suck 30 lollipops a day. This random assignment ensures that known and unknown confounders are equal between the groups. And so it means that when we follow up the groups after 30 years, if the smoking group has an increased incidence of lung cancer compared to the control group, then that's strong evidence that smoking causes lung cancer. Obviously, this is an impractical and unethical study that we could never do for real. But fortunately, Mendelian randomization offers us a natural experiment to provide us with information on the causal relationship between smoking and lung cancer. So what we can do is we can take a variant that we know is related to heaviness of smoking. And such a variants exist. We have identified them in genome-wide association studies. So for example, there is a variant in one of the nicotinic receptor genes, CRONA5, that's related to how heavily individuals smoke. So individuals who carry the variant are more likely to smoke more heavily, they're more likely to inhale more deeply, and so on and so forth. And so what we can do is we can use the random segregation and independent assortment of alleles at that locus to group individuals into, let's say, two groups. So one group, heavy smokers that have the CC genotype, and another group who are light or non-smokers who have the CT or TT genotype. Again, Mendel's laws of segregation and independent assortment ensure that the confounders on average should be equal between the two groups. And so if we compare those two groups in terms of lung cancer, if lung cancer incidence is more common in the heavy smoking group defined by their genotype than in the light or non-smoking group defined by its genotype, then again, that's evidence that smoking causally affects lung cancer risk. Another way of conceptualizing Mendelian randomization is with a directed acyclic graph. So basically, we are interested in whether a SNP, which is associated with an exposure of interest, is also associated with an outcome through its relationship through the exposure. And this sort of DAG framework is very useful for describing the three core assumptions underlying Mendelian randomization. So number one is that the SNP is associated with the exposure of interest. So this is an assumption that's very easy to prove. So pretty much any SNP that you can take from a GWAS that's been replicated in an independent set of individuals, that SNP is going to be robustly associated with an exposure of interest. Core assumption number two is that the SNP is not associated with any confounders of the exposure outcome relationship. Now, this is an assumption which we can never prove, but Mendel's laws of segregation and independent assortment strongly suggest that this should be the case for most SNPs that we use in Mendelian randomization. We can increase confidence in the validity of this assumption if we were to, for example, take a group of variables that we knew were confounders of the exposure outcome association. And if we were to test for association between those confounders and our SNP, if there was no significant association between the SNP and our confounders, then that would increase our confidence that core assumption two was satisfied. But note that we could never prove for sure that that assumption is going to hold across every single possible confounding variable because we couldn't measure them all. So assumption number two is strongly implied by Mendel's laws, but we can't prove it for certain. One confounder that you should be particularly aware of is confounding due to population stratification. So in an MR study, it's very important to do your study on as homogeneous sample of individuals ancestrally as possible, or at the very least, make sure you include corrections for population stratification, for example, by including ancestrally informative principal components. The third core assumption is that the SNP is only associated with the outcome through its relationship with the exposure. And this is really the key assumption with Mendelian randomization. And for people who have a problem with the method, this is the assumption that they most often have a problem with. So this assumption is basically saying that there's no pleiotropic relationship between the SNP and the outcome. So another way of saying that is that there's no horizontal pleiotropy between the SNP and the outcome. So all the relationship goes through the exposure. And again, this is never an assumption that we can prove beyond a doubt to be correct, but there are various sensitivity tests that we can do to identify when there's likely to be problematic pleiotropy in our data set, and indeed methods that we can use to either correct for that pleiotropy or make our inferences less sensitive to it. Now, if we have a genetic variant that satisfies those three core assumptions, then we say that the genetic variant is an instrumental variable or a good instrument. So in summary, why are genetic associations so special? Well, it's because they are robust to confounding due to Mendel's laws. So the law of segregation means that the genetic markers are or should be independent of environmental confounders. And the law of independent assortment means that genetic variants should segregate independently of other genetic traits. So the variants should be robust to genetic confounding. Also, Mendelian randomization uses SNPs. We know that SNPs must come before the exposure because you obviously inherit genetic material at conception. So the direction of causality is always known. So reverse causality is less of a problem for Mendelian randomization studies. So genetic variants are potentially very good instrumental variables, and using genetic variants is a special case of what we call instrumental variables analysis. So you'll sometimes hear me use that phrase, either an IV for the genetic variant, or I refer to Mendelian randomization as a form of instrumental variables analysis.